Breaking news. In 24 hours, hackers are threatening to release the most personal information of its high-profile customers. Posting this photo online a short time ago, they say they will expose the details after Medibank refused to pay the ransom. Lara Vella following the story. Lara, 10 million customers waiting for this to unfold.
Carl, you can only imagine just how worried those almost 10 million Medibank and AHM customers are this morning, in particular around 500,000 of them whose personal medical records have been breached. Carl, that includes everything from the locations where they've had medical procedures to the exact codes that identify what medical procedures they've been treated for. So that could include everything from a woman who's had an abortion to someone who is receiving treatment for substance abuse. Carl, of course, this follows just a day after this threat follows at the announcement from Medibank's chief executive that the company will not be paying a ransom to the hackers for fear it'll further expose Australians to the risk of extortion and that there's no guarantee that the data won't be published anyway. Now, though, this morning, Carl, we have this latest development online. Today has spoken to some of our tech experts this morning, and it does appear that this is the real deal. Essentially, what's happened here is there's been some chatter on a dark web forum. It appears that these hackers are now threatening to release all of this information in the next 24 hours. Let's hear from the company's CEO who was speaking yesterday.
You can't trust criminals. The reality is, based on our expert advice, that this would increase the likelihood of the criminal using this data, exploiting further our customers and also putting further Australians at risk by being known to pay ransoms.
Carl, you can only imagine the number of briefings that the company has had in the past few days and in the past few weeks with everyone from cybersecurity agencies to the federal government and also the Australian Federal Police. Now this appears to be the worst case scenario unfolding and is certainly the next escalation in this situation. The AFP says it is continuing its investigation, Carl.
Lara, thank you.
In a new development, Hawthorn Football Club has made attempts to resolve its club's racism row. Today, Melbourne reporter Christina Hearn is at AFL House for us this morning. Chris, were they successful?
Amelia, it was unsuccessful. It was an unsuccessful attempt. Hawthorn officials did hold mediation talks with the lawyer representing one First Nations former player and their partner, but those talks did not progress far. According to The Age, other Indigenous players and their partners involved in this investigation did not want to enter mediation talks. This does come after claims of racism and bullying were levelled against former Hawks officials and coaches, including Alistair Clarkson. And those claims are being investigated by an independent AFL panel. And those findings are expected at the end of next month. But what this shows is that the Hawthorn Football Club are willing to go down the settlement path. And that is something that was recommended by the club's cultural review. Amelia.
Thank you, Chris. Up to 100,000 workers have been brought into Australia under suspected visa scams, fuelling fears about illegal labour in the country. The federal government will launch a review of the visa rule system, with a second inquiry being prepared to investigate migration scams. The review follows a major investigation by 60 Minutes and 9 newspapers into allegations of widespread visa rorting linked to sex trafficking.
Sri Lankan cricket player Danushka Gunathilaka has been refused bail and will stay behind bars after facing court for an alleged sexual assault in Sydney. Today, Sydney reporter Gabriel Boyle joins us from Silverwater Prison. Gabby, good morning. When will he face court again?
Alex, good morning to you. Well, some time from now. In the meantime, however, the Sri Lankan T20 player will be waking this morning here at Silverwater Correctional Complex. Instead of wearing his team's national tracksuit, he'll be wearing prison greens, a green tracksuit issued after he entered the front door of the prison here. He is facing incredibly serious charges, 4 counts of sexual intercourse without consent, and it all relates to an alleged incident, a woman he met on Tinder from the eastern suburbs of Sydney. He has appeared before court and bail was refused. Outside of court, we heard from his lawyer.
We don't know exactly what happened. It is in court. We will know very soon.
We put our position to the court. There was no unacceptable risk, but the court disagreed. So we have to accept the decision.
Alex, I can tell you that 31-year-old Danushka Gunathilaka will reappear before court on the 12th of January. His teammates, of course, flew back to Sri Lanka over the weekend. A very difficult few weeks for him behind bars.
Absolutely. Gabby, thank you.
The Queensland government is assuring the state there will be no blackouts this summer after failures at a major power station. Today, Queensland reporter Andrea Crothers is in Brisbane. Andrea, only one of the four generators are back online.
Carl, it means three of those four generators remain down at what is one of Queensland's largest coal-fired power stations. It suffered a major breakdown at the end of last week. But the Queensland government, it is insisting that it will still be fine. Currently, it says that electricity supply in the state is around double what demand is, and that there'll be more than enough to get Queensland through what is expected to be another hot summer. Either way, the state opposition is still seizing on these power problems. They're pushing for an independent inquiry. The government so far has pushed back on that, instead saying workplace health and safety investigators will do an audit. But as we prepare for another hot summer, the potential of any blackout will be the last thing Queenslanders want to hear, Carl.
Andrea, that's for sure. Thank you.
US President Joe Biden and former President Donald Trump are on the campaign trail today in a last-ditch effort for votes. While the House and 35 seats in the Senate are up for grabs tomorrow, Joe Biden says there is much more on the ballot at the midterms.
We all know in our bones that our democracy is at risk. Latest polls say 76% of American people worry about maintaining our democracy. And we know that this is your generation's moment to defend it, to preserve it, to choose it.
Trump is holding a rally in Ohio later today, with rumors he may even announce his run for presidency. We will be crossing live to the US in the next half hour. Renewable energy is one of the hot topics at the United Nations Climate Summit in Egypt this week. Former US Vice President Al Gore has made an impassioned call for leaders to stop using fossil fuels.
We have a credibility problem, all of us. We're talking and we're starting to act, but we're not doing enough. It is a choice to continue this pattern of destructive behavior. We have other choices.
More than 100 heads of state, climate groups and activists are in town making plans on how to safeguard the future of the planet.
There are calls this morning to expand eligibility for defence internships in order to bolster national security. Isabella Staszkowski is at the Shrine of Remembrance this morning. Is a former Prime Minister is pushing for this change.
Carl, good morning to you. He certainly is. Former Prime Minister Tony Abbott wants compulsory national service to return. So listen up if you're in year 12, if you're finishing school, or if you're 18. That would mean that you would spend 1 year giving back to your community and to your country. It wouldn't necessarily have to be in the armed forces. You could spend that year in an Indigenous community or even giving back in aged care. The former PM says the relationship between government and people should be a two-way street. I think there'll be a lot of on that. Further, there are some universities which are calling for these defence internships to be further expanded. At the moment, they're only available for Australian citizens, but they would like them to be expanded to foreign citizens as well. That could bolster the defence force by some 100,000 each and every year. So both plans incredibly bold. Carl, I think there'll be a lot of debate around the country about both of those.
Isa, thank you.